lower extremity aneurysms last time. Today we'll be discussing about upper extremity aneurysms. So I'm not again going into basics of what is an aneurysm and the etiology and all that. We have discussed multiple number of times already. So directly starting with the upper extremity. And upper extremity aneurysms are pretty uncommon. So right from the start, I'd like to mention that a very less data is available for most of the aneurysms, like an axillary or a brachial or anything. There's a lot of paucity in the literature. So we don't have a lot of data, and that we'll find out as we go ahead with the presentation. So upper extremity aneurysms are extremely uncommon. However, most common out of all the vessels is the arch vessel aneurysm, and a bit of history. So in 1805, and I think there was this quote shared in the VSI group also very recently, that Astley Cooper was the first person to perform ligation of an aneurysm for the treatment of an aneurysm. However, that I don't feel is completely true, because it was first performed by John Hunter for popliteal aneurysm. But because he did not record that case was never recorded by he himself. It was a hearsay, and someone else after a few months or years had recorded that case, saying that it was done in 1785. We have that evidence. Otherwise, as of literature, 1805 and 1808 were the two cases performed by Dr. Astley Cooper, who did carotid artery ligations. In 1818, innominate artery was ligated by Sir Valentine Mott for the treatment of subclavian aneurysm. And in 1864, the first successful treatment of the subclavian artery aneurysm was performed by ligating the right common carotid and innominate artery both. And the aneurysm recurred and ruptured about 10 years later, but the patient survived for 10 years. And in 1892, Halsted at John Hopkins was the first to combine ligation with resection of the aneurysm. So it was until 1892 that the concept of resection came for the treatment of an aneurysm. So going into the epidemiology, arch vessel aneurysms consist of only 1% of peripheral aneurysms. Most common cause in most aneurysms is degenerative. Other causes like trauma, fibromuscular dysplasia, syphilis infection, other vasculitis, tuberculosis, lymphadenitis, etc. are there. And there is a report by Curry et al., which has a series of 74 arch vessel aneurysms, out of which 63% were degenerative, and majority were again in the older age group, more than 60 years of age. Plenty of degenerative arch aneurysms, 30 to 50% are associated with an aortoiliac or other peripheral aneurysms. So subclavian artery is most common out of all the arch vessels, 50% of the cases. Innominate artery consists of 2 to 5% of the cases. Carotid artery aneurysms are extremely rare, less than 2%. And the other percentage which are missing out of the 100 is the combination of the few aneurysms. And bilateral common carotid aneurysms are associated with tachyasus, but again, we do not have the number because very less reported cases. And again, pseudoaneurysm, they are considerably more frequent than the degenerative aneurysms, and their complications, as we know, of blunt or penetrating trauma or inadvertent cannulation while accessing the vein, or an operative dissection or an infection like TB lymphadenitis or something. So how do the arch vessel aneurysms present? 75% are asymptomatic. If symptomatic, the presenting symptoms can be either local, a thromboembolization, or compressive. So local symptoms are pretty obvious. There'll be a pain from compression. There'll be acute expansion or stretching sort of a pain. There'll be upper extremity neurological dysfunction. If it is, it can be considered as a compressive symptom rather than a local symptom. and there is a chance of thromboembolization, upper extremity acute and chronic ischemic symptoms, and there can be transient ischemic attacks or stroke, especially when carotids are involved. Then the set of symptoms would be compressive symptoms, hoarseness because of compression of recurrent laryngeal nerve, Horner's syndrome, respiratory insufficiency or stridor, or difficulty in breathing basically because of tracheal compression, dysphagia because of esophageal compression by a aberrant right subclavian that we'll be discussing a bit in detail later on, and hemoptysis from the erosion of the apex of lung or into the bronchial vessels. The patient will have a typical supraclavicular mass. Now there are incidences where a patient might present with a pulsatile supraclavicular mass, and it turns out to be nothing but a tortuous elongated common carotid or a subclavian artery. So not necessarily that every easily pulsatile visible mass should be considered as an aneurysm before investigating it, which is opposite in the case of a popliteal artery aneurysm, like we discussed, that if the popliteal artery is easily palpable, always suspect an aneurysm. Here it is the other way around. And patient might have a supraclavicular bruit, might be heard. There'll be diminished or absent pulses in the distal part of the arm, forearm. There'll be signs of microembolization like a bruit finger syndrome, or brachial plexus compression might be causing its signs and symptoms. There can be vocal cord paralysis or a Horner syndrome from the compression of a stellate ganglion. How will we diagnose? Again, the same modalities that we discussed last time. It is a Doppler ultrasound, which can diagnose, but it will have its own anatomical limitations, especially in arch vessels. And conventional angiography versus CT MRI versus CT angiography. So conventional angiography is the gold standard. CT angiography is the most preferred method. Minimally invasive method, we can know the extent of aneurysm. We can know the access sites from where we can access the aneurysm. Especially, we can know the distal circulation, the distal reformation of the arteries. If there is a case of thromboembolism from the aneurysm, we can know the competency of the vertebral circulation, which is very important in cases of subclavian artery aneurysms. And we can know the excess anatomical suitability for the endovascular repair. So the treatment of arch vessel aneurysms is the treatment of choice is an open repair. Resection or an endoaneurysmography and reestablishment of the arterial continuity. More commonly with an interposition prosthetic graft. Or it can also be for a very small aneurysm, we can perform an end-to-end anastomosis. And ligation without direct or extra-anatomical reconstruction would result in ischemic symptoms in nearly 25% of the cases. Hence, treatment of choice would always be to re-establish arterial continuity. So now coming to all different arteries. So I'll be discussing treatment of the innominate artery first. The approach would be a median sternotomy extending into the right neck. Proximally, there'll be control at arch of aorta. Distally, right subclavian artery and common carotid arteries will be dissected and controlled, and the aneurysm is resected with reconstructed with a prosthetic graft. Now, there is an anatomical classification given by Kiefer et al. To guide the surgical repair. There are three types, group A, B, and C. So group A and B aneurysms are for group A. Group A is involving the not Hello. Hello. The anatomical classification guides the surgical repair. there is a group A, which is aneurysmal dilatation after the origin, distal to the origin of the innominate. Group B is involving the origin of the innominate, however, not involving the arch of aorta. And group C is involving the arch of aorta as well as the innominate. So for group A and group B aneurysms, the proximal graft anastomosis to the native ascending aorta proximal to the innominate origin is possible. So it will be excision or a resection of the aneurysm with proximal anastomosis to the arch of aorta in the healthy segment. And then the graft is then to the uninvolved distal. Or a patch angioplasty of the aorta may be required. So we need to repair the origin, especially in cases of group B type, group B of innominate aneurysms. For lesions extending into the origins of the subclavian or common carotid, a bifurcated graft or a branch graft may be required to address both the arteries separately. And for type C innominate artery aneurysms, they usually require an aortic arch repair. So aortic arch and innominate artery prosthetic graft is graft replacement using a cardiopulmonary bypass and hypothermic circulatory arrest. Coming to subclavian artery aneurysms. Subclavian artery in general can be divided into proximal, that is typical, it is usually degenerative, and a distal, which is usually related to the thoracic outlet syndrome. So for proximal right subclavian artery, the approach would be a median sternotomy with an extension into the supraclavicular fossa. Now the supraclavicular and infraclavicular incisions and dissection of the clavicle, they might be needed for a better exposure of the subclavian. Again, it all depends on the exact location of the aneurysm. And for proximal left subclavian aneurysms, the left thoracotomy is the preferred approach combined with the supraclavicular exposure. For mid and distal subclavian, a supraclavicular incision is sufficient more often than not. However, if needed, it can be extending into the infraclavicular or a sternotomy. In performing the subclavian repairs, endovascular alternative for control of the proximal or distal vessel may be used. The most important part of the subclavian artery aneurysm repair is the control of the vertebral artery, reconstruction rather of the vertebral artery by reimplantation, particularly if this is the dominant vertebral artery. Or for cases in which the contralateral vertebral artery is hypoplastic or diseased. In this image, we can see how vertebral artery is anastomosed with the thyrocervical trunk to re-establish the arterial continuity. So it was seen that the aneurysm dissection with graft replacement had excellent long-term results. And in one of the largest reported series, it was mentioned that normal upper leg extremity circulation was well maintained and no procedure related complications during a mean follow-up period of nearly 10 years. Now, since many patients are unfit for open repair because of their advanced age or multiple comorbidities, patient selection is very imperative, that a proper selection and optimization of the patient must be done. And what would be the contraindications of an open repair? That is severely compromised pulmonary function, prior sternotomy or prior dissection of that area, or and hemodynamic instability, of course. So what options do we have for endovascular repair? So in surgically unfit in patients which you're not able to treat with open repair, we'll require an endovascular approach. There is an attractive option for patients who are unfit. It can be especially in cases which are hemodynamically unstable, like actively bleeding or coagulopathic patients with an iatrogenic injury or a penetrating injury of the arch vessels. And important to note that aneurysms secondary to connective tissue disorders should also be treated with endovascular because they are direct resection and anastomosis to a diseased vessel might lead to numerous complications. So two very important indications for endovascular would be a hemodynamic instability or a surgically unfit patient, and aneurysms secondary to connective tissue disorders. Here the and ha, so proximal and mid portion would be the most amenable to the endovascular repair. Distal portion is located between the clavicle and the first rib. Hence, endografts are subject to compression, deformation, and even fracture. So endovascular may be preferred, but endovascular itself has a lot of limitations. So it is unusual for true subclavian or innominate aneurysms to have adequate proximal and distal landing zones. The coverage of branch vessels, such as right carotid or vertebral arteries, internal mammary, when it has been used for coronary bypasses, may not be feasible. And it might overlap with your stent graft, and it, again, a lot of complications. Endograft placement in the right subclavian artery has a risk of stroke from the embolic debris, which gets dislodged into the right common carotid because of their their adjacent origins. And the vertebral artery, we already discussed that it is vulnerable and it may be covered with a stent graft, and the posterior circulation stroke may occur. So whenever the origin of the vertebral artery is involved by the aneurysm, coil embolization of the ipsilateral vertebral artery is desirable to prevent future branch vessel endolink. But if that is the dominant vertebral artery, we must take care that it has to be revascularized. It has to either by a bypass or by another a fenestration or whatever source. For endovascular repair, the approach would be either a transbrachial or a transfemoral approach. And both balloon mounted and self expandable endografts have been used. However, the most frequently used in India would be the Fluency by Bard. Viban, though described in detail, is not available in India. And most endografts use the 7 French to 9 French delivery sheets. And because of the discrepancy in the proximal and distal landing zone diameters, a combination of different sizes can also be used. And the disadvantage of the endovascular repair is that we still do not know the mid and long term results of these techniques. So, sir, am I audible, sir?
Go ahead.
Okay. So, discussing in short about the Fluency endograft. So it is a flexible self-expanding vascular prosthesis. It comes in a variety of diameters, starting from 6 up to 13.5 mm, and the length ranging from 40, 60, 80, 100, and 120 mm. It is comprised of a expanded polytetrafluoroethylene fabric encapsulating a nitinol framework, except at the flared edges, both the ends of the graft, which have a radiopaque tantalum markers. And the inner lumen is carbon impregnated, and the length of the uncovered portion of the stent graft is approximately 2 mm at each end. So very frequently used in India. Now, the third approach for a subclavian artery aneurysm repair is the hybrid, a combination of endovascular plus open. So embolization can be performed with coils or a vascular plug for the proximal subclavian artery. And distally, the artery can be transposed or the carotid subclavian bypass can be performed. Another option is complete exclusion of the subclavian aneurysm facilitated by ligation of the artery proximal to the distal anastomosis of the carotid subclavian bypass. Again, vertebral artery and internal mammary should be taken care of, especially internal mammary in cases which might require a future bypass or already have been bypassed. Another technique and for hybrid would be endograft into the innominate artery in a retrograde fashion via the carotid subclavian bypass limb. So we can put in a plug and then insert an endograft and then finish the bypass. again, cerebral embolization is minimized in this by occluding the anterograde carotid flow. And long-term durability of endografts in arch vessels is unknown. Short-term patency of the subclavian stent graft ranges from 83 to 100% over a mean follow-up of 7 to 29 months. Deformation and fracture stenosis of the stenosis from intimal hyperplasia have been reported and may limit the application of the endovascular repair. So this is about the subclavian artery. Overall, open surgery is the treatment of choice. There are multiple endovascular and hybrid options available, and patient selection and patient profile plays a huge role in deciding which treatment to be given. Coming to aberrant subclavian artery. So most common congenital anomaly of the aortic arch is an aberrant subclavian artery, noted in 0.5 to 1% of the population. Here, the subclavian artery arises from the proximal descending thoracic aorta distal to the left subclavian artery, and typically it arises posterior and inferior on the arch, and 80% of the aberrant SCAs will crosses the midline between the esophagus and the spine. Less commonly, it can also cross between the esophagus and the trachea or anterior to the trachea. Thing to be noted is that most patients with an aberrant subclavian artery will be asymptomatic, and aberrant subclavian artery is associated with a non-recurrent right laryngeal nerve, because the right laryngeal nerve usually coils around the subclavian artery, and that is also a part of the embryological development of the laryngeal nerve. So aberrant subclavian, what happens if the aberrant subclavian artery turns into an aneurysm? So it is noted in either gender, older age group, and majority of these require interventions because they are symptomatic or there is this risk of rupture. Clear size criteria has not been established, very limited data available, but the proposed repair of aneurysms is larger than 3 cm in good risk patients by Sine et al. Comerals diverticulum. So when this degenerative aneurysm changes are noted in up to 60% of the patients in the proximal portion of the aberrant subclavian artery. In 1936, Comeral described the diverticulum of the aorta at the origin of the anomalous subclavian. And in 1956, McClellan et al. First called the attention to the clinical significance of this aneurysmal change noted by Comeral. And Kiefer et al. Kiefer, who proposed the grouping of the innominate vein, as we saw earlier, he reported largest case series of 55 cases, surgically treated 33 adults with aberrant subclavian arteries, 17 of whom had comeral diverticulum or aneurysmal change of the thoracic aorta at the origin of the aberrant subclavian artery. So nearly 50% of aberrant subclavians had an aneurysmal change at the origin. Here we can see the diagram where you can note a slight aneurysmal change just distal to the origin of the aberrant right subclavian artery. Kiefer et al. Also proposed a classification for aberrant subclavian artery based on the clinical presentation and anatomy. So here the group 1 was the aberrant subclavians which had non-aneurysmal causing compressive symptoms. Group 2 is occlusive disease of a non-aneurysmal aberrant right subclavian artery. Group 3 is aneurysmal dilatation but without aortic involvement. And group 4 is aneurysmal dilatation with aortic involvement. How would they present? So according to Kiefer et al., 22 patients had, out of the 55 we know, had 22 of them had aneurysmal degeneration. 11 out of 33 patients, out of total 33 patients, 22 had aneurysmal degeneration and 11 were without any aneurysmal degeneration, presented with dysphagia, and 5 of them had symptoms of upper limb ischemia. Stone et al. Reported that 24 patients were diagnosed with an aberrant right subclavian, 66% were asymptomatic at the time of presentation, and 34% had various symptoms of dysphagia or upper extremity ischemia or findings of an aneurysmal degeneration. Sometimes diagnosed incidentally, but usually present with, so we noted in the previous studies also that nearly 40 to 50% were asymptomatic, more than 50 to 60 were symptomatic. They can present with dysphagia because of esophageal compression, dyspnea because of tracheal compression, chest pain from expansion or symptoms of right upper limb extremity ischemia, emergently with aneurysmal rupture or a dissection. Aneurysm rupture in these cases seems to be unrelated to the size of aneurysm. And approximately 1/5 of the reported patients with this anomaly had an associated aortic aneurysm as well. So the treatment would be for an aberrant subclavian artery, open is the usually performed preferred method via the right supraclavicular incision. The aberrant subclavian artery is ligated left to the esophagus at its near its origin, and the distal end of the subclavian is then transposed or anastomosed with the end to side with the right common carotid artery. This approach is satisfactory when proximal subclavian is not aneurysmal. What if it is aneurysmal? So aneurysmal treatment of aberrant subclavian artery aneurysm, again, open approach is the preferred method, resection or exclusion of the aneurysmal artery with vascular reconstruction of the subclavian artery. There are multiple procedures. The best approach depends on the anatomic characteristics of the lesion, patient fitness, and acuity of presentation. So there is some data in an elective setting, a staged approach with right carotid subclavian bypass or transposition, that is end subclavian to side carotid, preceding the left thoracotomy and aneurysmal resection with overswing of the origin of the aortic arch, is attractive because of it decreases the risk of cerebral and right upper extremity embolization. Simple side-biting clamp exclusion may be possible, although interposition repair of the aorta itself may be necessary in up to 30% of the patients with aortic involvement. So, few cases with such staged approaches, bypasses, and excision of the aneurysm or ligation of the aneurysm have been reported. Limitations of open repair are the high rates of neurological complications, high mortality, morbidity, particularly in patients who are unfit for an open major vascular reconstruction, and a previous thoracotomy, which increases the difficulty of the dissection. Combination of aortic endografting and extra-anatomical bypass is an appealing combination for treatment for this condition, which is typically a hybrid procedure. So endovascular occlusion by the plug can be done, but again, if the origin itself is aneurysmally dilated, that might not be possible. And right subclavian artery, we note that in cases of dissection, when treated endovascularly, we know that the stent graft is placed to cover the origin of the subclavian and the subclavian is plugged. Then less than 25% of the cases, according to the data, produce any ischemic symptoms. So that is also one method to treat where a stent graft can be placed at the covering the origin of the aberrant subclavian aneurysmally dilated artery, and distal plugging to completely exclude the aneurysm. So this is the example of that. Endograft can effectively exclude the antegrade flow into the aberrant subclavian aneurysm, and it needs a carotid to right subclavian artery anastomosis. Majority of the cases, the orifices of the aberrant right and left subclavian arteries are situated at the same level or in close proximity. So to effectively occlude the origin of the aberrant vessel with a thoracic endograft, placement requires exclusion of both subclavians. Bilateral occlusion is not recommended because of subclavian steel syndrome or ischemia symptoms or spinal ischemia, stroke. Hence, thoracic aortic endografting usually needs to be combined with revascularization of one or both subclavian arteries. Bilateral subclavian transposition or carotid subclavian bypass procedures may be needed before the endovascular treatment. There have also been reports where the endovascular treatment is carried out first, followed by observation whether the patient develops any upper extremity ischemic symptoms, and if needed, subclavian to carotid bypasses or transpositions have been done. This endograft plus a bypass significantly reduces the mortality morbidity in the patients. It can become the standard of treatment, but again, lack of data to prove that it is the better method. Long-term outcomes are not established, and it is unclear whether covering the aortic origin of the aneurysm using aortic endograft can effectively relieve the compressive symptoms of the diverticulum, and if they can prevent the rupture of the aneurysm. Endovascular approach for aneurysms would aneurysm of right subclavian, aberrant subclavian arteries, intraluminal placement of an endograft confined to the vessel has been reported by Davidian et al. Hope et al. Report occluded the aberrant subclavian artery aneurysm with two Amplatzer septal occluders at proximal and distal end. And the eventual need for revascularization of the right upper extremity could be assessed after the procedure, like I told a few minutes earlier, and there is paucity of data regarding the pure endovascular procedures. Coming to axillary artery aneurysm. So axillary artery, extremely rare, usually caused by a blunt or a penetrating trauma. Post-traumatic axillary aneurysms are usually in young men involved in athletic activities that are associated with repetitious or a forceful extension of the upper extremity, probably related to the repeated abduction and external rotation of the upper extremity with a downward displacement of the humeral head. Here we can see that the circumflex humeral arteries that usually arise from the third part of the axillary artery, they encircle the surgical neck of the humerus. We can note here. And they create a tethering effect on the axillary artery, which is fixed in position relative to the humerus. So repeated compressions on the axillary artery can lead to an intimal damage, thrombosis, or an aneurysm formation because of the circumflex humeral arteries. Degenerative aneurysms are not very common as compared to axillary pseudoaneurysms. Usually occur because of penetrating trauma, but they also can be because of some blunt trauma or humeral fractures and an anterior dislocation of the shoulder. There is excellent collateral circulation around this area. Hence, the distal perfusion is usually not affected. They present late chronic pseudoaneurysms with local symptoms rather than thromboembolic symptoms. And they can lead to serious and permanent neurological disability because of hemorrhage into the axillary sheath and compression of the brachial plexus. So suspecting blunt trauma with a normal pulse examination, but brachial plexus palsy, because the likelihood of concomitant vascular injury is very high in these cases. Diagnosis, again, we have the same modalities. However, Doppler ultrasound would be very sensitive and specific for axillary artery because of easy accessibility and less anatomical inhibitions for the doctor. CT angiogram, preferred method, and a conventional angiogram, gold standard. Crutch-induced blunt trauma producing an aneurysm dilatation of the axillary artery in older patients has also been reported. So the thrombus is usually loosely adherent to the damaged intima and may be dislodged by the further trauma of the crutches and can be a source of acute, chronic, or a repetitive emboli. Suspected when a patient who has been using crutches for a prolonged period presents with absent brachial pulse or any signs of blue finger syndrome or distal ischemia. So what is the treatment? Again, surgical treatment with resection of the aneurysm and an interposition vein graft is the treatment of choice. Brachial plexus and surrounding vascular structures should be protected during the dissection of the aneurysm. Autogenous vein graft are the preferred method because of improved patency rates compared to artificial conduits. Occasionally, an adjacent segment of the axillary or a brachial vein has been used to reconstruct the artery, but the vein is extremely thin-walled and may itself become aneurysmal with time compared to GSV. For this reason, a segment of saphenous vein is the conduit of choice, and long-term results with interposition vein grafts have been reported to be excellent. Endovascular treatment of an axillary aneurysm would be placement of an endograft. It is sufficient to obtain complete exclusion of the aneurysm cavity. Occasionally, embolization with microcoils of the branches to isolate the sac and prevent endoleak has been done, reported. But there is a review of literature by Dubois et al. And it says that overall patency during the follow-up period was reported to be 84.4% of the endograft placement. Endovascular repair of axillary aneurysms and pseudoaneurysms should be considered as an alternative in surgical in treatment of the patients with major comorbidities or high surgical risk. This is the example of the endovascular repair where you can note that after the placement of the stent graft, there is there's no more endoleak and it has been successfully excluded. Brachial artery aneurysms. Mostly these are false aneurysms secondary to repetitive trauma or iatrogenic complications. Intravenous drug abuse is currently a frequent cause of infected pseudoaneurysms in the anticubital fossa, and arteriovenous access creation can lead to aneurysmal degeneration of the donor arteries also. Uncommon causes of true aneurysms of the brachial artery would be congenital connective tissue abnormalities like type 4 Ehlers-Danlos, Kawasaki syndrome, Berger's disease, Kaposi's sarcoma, cystic adventitial disease. They present mostly with symptoms of median nerve compression or local pain. Other symptoms can be distal ischemia because of thrombosis of the aneurysm and distal embolization. Diagnosis, more often than not, it is diagnosed on physical examination and can be confirmed on a Doppler ultrasound. Arteriography is necessary to delineate the extent of the aneurysm, to assess the sites of vascular occlusion, and to determine whether anatomical variants are present that might affect the reconstruction. Simple iatrogenic brachial artery false aneurysm can usually be repaired without any need for angiography. Because of high incidence of symptoms and complication, it is mandatory to repair a brachial artery aneurysms, and it should be offered to all patients. The open repair is the preferred method. It can be done under local, regional, or general. Most preferable is the local anesthesia and resection with either a patch or interposition vein grafting, or a resection and primary anastomosis, or in cases of iatrogenic aneurysm, simple suture repair. All are the available options depending on the size and the etiology of the aneurysm. Patency of the vein graft at a mean follow-up of 16 months was found to be 100% in one of the studies. So that is about the open repair. Coming to endovascular repair for brachial artery aneurysms, only two case reports have been described using the endograft for treatment of brachial artery aneurysm. In one case, a mycotic bacterial pseudoaneurysm developed secondary to MRSA wound infection that occurred after an emergency brachial artery bypass grafting using greater saphenous vein. This pseudoaneurysm was successfully treated with endograft and antibiotics. In a second case reported, brachial artery aneurysm was treated with an endograft in a patient that had sustained a gunshot wound to the left arm. This patient had a complex open humerus fracture and brachial plexus injury, initially treated with wound debridement, skin grafting, fixation, physical therapy. 2 months after the initial injury, he developed an acute arm pain and pulsatile mass. Arteriography confirmed near total transection of the proximal left brachial artery, and the origin of the pseudoaneurysm was successfully excluded with an endograft. there are only two reported cases of brachial artery being repaired with a endograft. Okay, so distally radial ulnar, and then no reported cases or no data regarding their aneurysmal changes. So that's it about the upper extremity aneurysms.